Hey folks, welcome back. Chris Garlock here with Michael Redmond, Nine Don Professional. And this is our latest in our AlphaGo versus the World Series. And I feel like we're sort of at the very end of the marathon, Michael, down to our last couple of games. And amazingly, after what this is game 58, and we have yet another top player. And this is one, again, that we haven't seen before.
Not in this series, yes. The player is Chang Hao, a very famous player, one of the iconic Chinese players, I would say. And he's one of the oldest players in this set of games because he's 40. He was born in 1976. So at the time of this game, that makes him 40 years old.
Wow.
He was, I think, about three times. He was very prominent in international and Chinese tournaments, but at least three times world champion. And he's a very nice person, actually. Very polite, very nice, very popular overseas in Japan, Korea, I think. Overall, one of the most popular top professionals that I know.
All right. You've had time to spend time with him, I guess?
Well, we don't speak the same language, but we have spent some time together. Very agreeable person. He speaks a few words in Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
So shall we get into the game?
Let's do that.
Okay, here we see AlphaGo playing away from an approach move to the white stars point. Chang Hao has the black stones. This is a position where you might be expecting black to be trying a Kobayashi-style opening, or otherwise black could just leave the Kakari and play the big Shimari, the big corner enclosure. Which is also, this is the modern way to do it, I suppose. But white plays a Kakari here. And this is one of the first examples of white playing away as a computer. It's one of the first examples of master playing away from a Kakari to the star point. And it turns out that black playing the double approach here is not as important as we used to think. And actually, of course, the computer-suggested move, the candidate move, is a kosumi here, sort of like the susaku kosumi. So I like the idea that this kosumi is coming back into fad because of AIs. When black plays here, at any point, white can press at this point. And this is supposed to be very big for white. Actually, in this game, white started from the corner. But this is a position where white could have pressed at D15. I think we saw this in a different game.
Yeah.
But it didn't happen in this game. In this game, white played this way. Chang Hao attaches to the corner. And this is a position where black had a number of options. Black could have played here, and something like this might happen. This actually is a very important pincer that white plays on the lower side. Or black can play this way, in which case white will take that opportunity to press in the upper left. So all of these would be fine for white. It turns out it might be a good idea for black to play the old-fashioned joseki, because this would give black an opportunity to get back to the upper left corner. In this case, black gets the tempo. Now, locally, this position, I would say this is good for white. Although black has the corner territory, that white has a more efficient shape, with these two black stones more or less wasted, and white having that strong position. This is a joseki that has sort of gone out of fashion. It usually works better when white has one extra stone somewhere on the side. So like if white is soldered with a pincer in that mark point, C9, for instance, then getting to the same position would be relatively good for white, for black, because of that wasted white stone. But when white does not have that move, just this way, the efficiency of white stones is good. I like it for white. But in this board position, the fact that black gets to the big point at 5, and that's an important point, the fact that black has the tempo to get there makes it playable for black. So actually, this might have been the best choice. And it all started because black played that approach move to the corner instead of protecting at the here. This would have been much more simple, making Miai of this point and the double card. It turns out that programs like Lilo Zero really like that pincer at H17. So they like that pincer on the upper side. In the game, Black attached here. This was the popular Joseki at the time. And now, now Black has a choice again. In the game, Black plays the Kosumi. Or Black could have... Maybe it's slightly better for Black to play this extension, but White will press here anyway. So this kind of variation is what is shown. It turns out pushing at 9 here is an important point, and Black should play that first before protecting the left side. So something like this would follow. You can see I've gotten carried away with the variation here.
Oh, wow. Holy moly.
Something like this will continue. It's perfectly playable for White, and Black has a lot of choices now. Like already... this territory is going to be safe on the third line, so Black's probably going to leave that position where White can play a move. For instance, White is looking at playing a move at F9 here.
Right.
Black will probably leave it anyway because it's not so important anymore. And maybe switch to the lower right corner. So that would be, in the case of a computer program, that might be the 3-3 point at R3, or it could be a Kakari from the outside like this. So one of these two points that I'm marking here. And the upper side is pretty big too, so something like this. So Black had a number of candidate moves at this point that were getting pretty good scores, and it was close to even. Just to get back to the game here, once White presses at this point, the game is slightly in White's favor. So it's something like 48% for Black. And so that's maybe like 1 point. 1 point worse for Black or something like that. So it's not something that I'd be noticing in the game.
Probably not time to resign just yet.
Not time to resign yet, right. So this is the point. This is another important point where Black played here. It seems so natural. And White is going to get a lot of mileage out of this cut here on the third line. And this is going to be very, very painful for Black. So it turns out that Black, at this point, had to play the push here, which would have made a big difference in that. So Black can push, and then with that momentum, you might say, Black could move to the lower side. Something like this might follow. It's not a big deal. Like the left side, provided these stones are out into the center, the stones in the lower left, then Black can allow White to play that. In fact, it's just the fact that this area in the lower left corner and connected to the lower side. Those two areas were both very important areas. So they were what are now called hotspots. While the left side was relatively lukewarm, I guess.
Mm.
So the fact that Black continued surrounding the left side actually made the rest of the game very, very difficult. And this turned out to be a very painful game for Chang Hao because we're going to see it happen. I think at the time I was sort of doubting the timing of White pushing through here, because when White pushes through here, White usually will be cutting on the second line immediately.
Right, right.
It wasn't a big deal. It's just that White's going to play it a few moves later. So White starts with the cut here. This is going to be very painful. Like, Black doesn't really want to be capturing it like this when White can play. And there you see, that's the difference where Black should have been playing that push earlier. The difference is that White gets this forcing move either this way or White could play it this way. Either way, it's going to be painful for Black. And then White will be getting to the lower side first. And because of the cut that White has played on third line here, Black doesn't have the option of cutting White at this point because of lack of liberties. So to get back to... So when White does that, Black plays from underneath. Black is trying to avoid that squeeze that I just showed you. This is not going to help him. Like, now White cuts, and if Black ignores that, it's going to be trouble for Black, however you look at it. Like, for instance, just to give one example of how this could work, if Black takes it this way, for instance, like, I'm sure there's a number of ways. I haven't really researched it yet, but for instance, this way. And if Black plays here, that's two interchangeable points. That's just a collapse for Black.
Yeah.
If black instead plays from underneath, now it's one of these two groups of two stones that's going to die. Black will probably have to save this side, but you know, this is very painful. It's too painful. It's a collapse. So black cannot capture that white stone. Black has to connect. And this kind of forcing move already is very painful for black, the fact that white gets this free attachment at the 3-3 point. And now white's going to squeeze again. So it's a double squeeze. Actually, you could say it's a triple squeeze, because white's squeezing from the center. After this, white plays here, and black still cannot leave it. If black plays away, this is going to be trouble. Like it's, I can see maybe it, it's not even a call. Yeah, it's not even a call. White will connect here, for instance. It's looking like maybe if white pushes through here, looks like it would be a ko. This would be a ko, but I don't think it's a ko if white just fills a liberty from behind. It doesn't work.
Oh, wow.
So, nice. Well, nice. Even a ko would be very painful. But, you know, so white plays here. Black has to answer again. This is so painful. Like, I would be thinking of resigning, really, but it's only about 43%. So maybe black's still winning a little bit before Komi.
Right.
But it is very, it's discouraging to be squeezed so much. Like white got this forcing move, white got this forcing move, and white forced three times here. So white got to the big pincer.
Ouch. Ouch.
And I'm going to call this the losing move. This was an oversight by Chang Hao, because black actually had to peep. And white will answer here. And this was the candidate move. I found this very interesting. This doesn't actually threaten to kill the corner, but the fact that pushing through here to cut will be forcing against white's group in the corner. It's putting pressure on the whole white group, mostly in particular, this L of white stones here. This
show folks what happens. It's pretty cool.
Okay. So for instance, if white plays something on this side, white can live in the corner. White has this forcing move, so white can just play a hana here. That's alive. But you see in this variation, these stones are becoming a very weak group.
Right.
And so even if white manages to save them, the move saving this group will be right on top of this black wall. So they will be pretty useless moves. For instance, white moves like this and like this have no value to the left side of the board. And if white is forced to play like this, the fact that white squeezed black on the left there is not so important anymore, because white was forced to play all these useless moves right next to the black wall. So white does not want to be forced to be playing like that. And so white will probably, instead of allowing that to happen, white probably has to play from above. So if white plays in this direction, moves out in this direction, the value of white six here is that white is out into the center and will not have to play these useless moves somewhere around here. White just doesn't want to get nearer to that solid black wall. But that means that it's going to create a flow of stones where black is moving out to the left, and black still has some potential there to cut at any point with sente. And so this would be relatively good for black. I mean, it's already a difficult game after white has squeezed three times on the left side of the board, but it would be better than the game variation. So just to compare with this, where black has a tempo and has jumped into the 3-3 point, has some potential to get some extra territory. In this game, I should say white is going to be hoping to make a big moyo on the upper side. And so that's where white has a lot of potential there. But that doesn't change the fact that black has gained a lot of momentum if we compare to the game variation. In the game, black cut here. And, you know, he's trying to be active. But he He missed the fact that white is about to sacrifice these two stones. It's very counterintuitive, because the instinct is that white has no strong counter here. That's what the snap judgment would be. So you would say maybe white's going to play here to establish that forcing move in the corner, and white's probably going to add another stone here. This would be exactly what black wants to do. So this would be a very good result for black. And it looks like playing here and pushing through is just unreasonable, because black can play here and squeeze like this. This doesn't look so good for white, right?
Ish.
Nice it looks shape. Terrible. So nice. The blind spot was that white can just ignore this cut and play here.
Oh.
If black pushes through here, now white can connect. And now black has to go back to the center. It's going to lose those stones on the side. So black has to capture the two stones. And these two stones, they're pretty important, but they come after white has done all that squeezing on the left side. Like all of those stones that black has played inside there, they're a big clump of useless stones now. Black has more stones than white inside that territory. So black has one or two wasted stones there. Taking all these white stones, it turns out it was just very unimportant. In fact, white can still curl around here at some point and have the tari here to shut off the center eventually. So it's not as important as two stones in the middle of the board usually are. It's a relatively unimportant two stones in the middle of the board.
Wow.
And that white territory on the lower side is really big. Like at this point, like this white already has 20 points there, more than 20 points.
Yeah,
so it's almost as much as black has on the left side. Like black, if we added Komi to that white territory in the lower left, right, it would be about the same as black's territory on the left side. And if you look at the rest of the board, white has the lower right corner and has all of this huge potential on the upper side of the board. It's already pretty close before Komi.
Right.
So white's almost winning by Komi. I think Katago was giving black a 1-point lead on the board.
Sort of an understandable oversight, though. It just hadn't occurred to me that white could just sack those stones. And you're right. It totally, it's like no big deal.
Totally useless. Yeah. I mean, it's almost automatic to assume that that white has to save those two stones.
Absolutely. Yeah.
But when it's shown to you on the board, it's pretty obvious that it was useless.
No chance after this, I'm assuming.
I'm going to stop here in this video, yes.
out of respect for Cho.
He went on to the end of the game, I think, yes. But it was painful.
Oh, dear. Wow. Well, it's, as we've been saying, I mean, it's a point, obviously, AlphaGo versus the world, but AlphaGo is just, it's not just that AlphaGo is winning, but it's often, doing it so easily and so solidly.
I think like in this game, it's just that it's demonstrating blind spots that are very prominent when the time limit is the time is limited, like it's only 30 seconds per move. So that was a factor there, but it's exploiting these blind spots that we in many cases didn't know we had.
Mm-hmm. Right, which of course means that, the folks that are growing up with the AIs are already just so much tougher, so much faster.
Yeah, they have some advantages. The young players find it so much more easy to learn these new ideas.
Right, exactly. Thank you so much, Michael. Thank you all for watching, and we'll see you next game.